Welcome back, friends. Today's session we're going to learn about Java variables. Okay. Yesterday we learned something about variable. You know what is variable. Using variable we can store certain amount of data inside a variable. Variable act as a container where we can store certain quantity of value. That is called as variable. We have seen that demo also yesterday class. Okay. Now we'll going to see more detail about the variable. In Java variable we can split as a three category: local variable, instance variable and static variable. Local variable, instance variable and static variable. Okay. When you look at this class, here I have declared two different variable. If you want to declare any variable as a static variable, we need to use static keyword. Okay. In the class level, after defining a class, I am defining one variable called a. That a type is int. Using int keyword, I am defining a variable called a. Then I am saying that variable type is a static, using static keyword. Now meaning of this line is I created one integer static variable, then assigning 10 value to variable a. This static variable called as a class level variable. Then inside a main function I created another variable called b using int keyword. Here I have not used any static, right? Static. Now this variable consider as a local variable. Whenever you define any variable inside a function, that variable called as a local variable. Whenever you define any variable at the class level using static keyword, that variable called as a class level variable. Whenever you define any variable at class level using static keyword, that variable called as a class level variable. Whenever you define any variable inside a function, that variable called as a local variable. Okay. What is difference between this variable and this variable? If you define any static variable in class level, that variable scope is entire class. That variable scope available in entire class. That meaning you can access this a variable inside a main function. You can access this a variable directly inside a main function. Okay. But this b variable scope is only available inside a main function. You cannot access this b variable outside a function. That is called as it's a local variable. Now we'll go to see the demo for this. Okay. System.out.println static variable a. Then I'll copy this, paste it, local variable b and b. Okay, and now I'm going to compile this. The static variable a 10. So a variable having a value 10, so it's printing a 10. Static variable a 10, then local variable b 40. So I am able to access this class level variable directly inside a main function. Okay, if you declare any variable at class level using static keyword, that variable available throughout the classes. That is the difference between static and local variable. Local variable only available inside a particular function where you defined. If you declare any variable like this here, int x equal to 90 or 10, whatever value, I press 30. If you declare like this, this variable call it as an instance variable. Instance variable. Okay. Now this variable we cannot access inside a main function. Okay. Now I don't want to explain about this. Okay. Whenever start object oriented programming, that time I will explain what is difference between the instance variable and the static variable more clearly. As of now, you understand. So if you declare any variable in class level using static keyword, that variable called as a class level variable. That variable we can access throughout the classes. If you declare any variable inside a function, that function called as a local variable, that variable scope is available only within that function. Within that function, outside the function we cannot access. That meaning the B variable I cannot access outside this main function. Okay. If you not define any, if you not define static keyword in the class level variable, that variable called as an instance variable. Now this x variable we cannot access here. It will give return error. It will return error when try to execute this program. Okay. Compile time itself it will return an error. Okay. Now I'm going to compile this. Then see, it's giving the error. Non-static variable x cannot be referenced from non-static context. So it's giving some error, right? So I will explain about this error later. I don't want to explain now. I don't want to confuse you. Okay. As of now, just understand how to define a static variable, how to define a local variable. When I start learning about Hooks concept, that time you will be clearly understanding. You will be clearly understanding what is instance variable, what is difference between instance and a static variable. Okay. I'll go into remove this. Let me compile again. Okay. Now going back to the slide. So you understand now what is local variable, what is static variable. Instance variable going to talk about later. Then Java data types. You know how to declare a variable. As of now, we seen how to declare a variable using int keyword. You know how to declare a variable using int keyword. Okay. Now we'll go to understand what is Java data type. Using Java data type, we can define different type of variable. In this program, right? In this program, I declared one variable called int b. So what is the meaning of this line is, I am creating a one variable called b. I want to store in that b variable only number value. That is the meaning of int. If you say int, that meaning you can store only number value in a particular variable. Here I am created a one variable called b. That type is int type. So that b variable contains only number value. So that is called as a Java data type. So using Java data type, we can define different type of variable. We can define different type of variable. Okay. When you look at here, primitive data type. The Java data type, we can split two categories. One is primitive data type, another one is non-primitive data type. Now we'll going to focus only primitive data type. Okay. Primitive data type. So we have already seen that int type. Using int type, we are able to define a number variable. We are able to create a number variable. Then what is short, what is long, what is float, what is double, and a byte, a boolean, char. We'll go to see one by one. Okay. Using int, short, long. Using these three type of variable, we can store only number value. With a whole number. But when you use int type, we can store certain range of value, For example, here you can see minimum value starting from here to here. If you define any variable as integer, we can store that number from this range to this range. If you define any variable as a short type, again in the short type I can store number value, but the range should be from this range to this range. You can use long type also. Long type also we can store a number value, but the range is from this type to from this. If you define any variable as a long type, in that long type you can store number value. Similarly int and short, but range is different when compared to int and short. See, here there's a range is very high here. From this range to this range we can store. Okay, so int, short, long, using these three data types, we can create a number variable, but each type having a different range of storing a number value. Okay, but what about float and double? Float is very similar to int. Float is very similar to int, but if you want to store any fractional number, any decimal numbers, for example 10.12, 30.42, like that, if you want to store some decimal portion, if you want to store some decimal portion in your variable, I want to store decimal portion in your variable, in that case we can go with float and double. Float is very similar to int, double is very similar to long. Okay, so float, double, both are same. Using these variables we can store decimal value, but range is different. Float is very similar to int type, double is very similar to long type. Only difference is we can store a decimal part. Okay. Now we're going to see this demo for this variable types. I have already defined int b, int type. Now I want to define long 80. I can define some long numbers, then long var, then float equal to float f var. Then double d var. Okay. I want to print this. Okay, long variable. Long back. L bar. Float variable. F bar. Double variable. D bar. Okay, now when I compile this program, definitely I will get the compilation error, I believe. Okay, let's see what is the compilation error is coming. So I got the compilation error. It's saying that possibly Lucy conversion from double to float. Here I'm saying float fvar 30389. Okay. Now I want to store this value, my float data type variable. I want to store it, but what compiler saying is this value is considered as a double. If you define any number value with a decimal portion, your Java compiler by default understand that particular value is a double type. That particular type is a double type. Here I am defining fvar as a float type. Now I am trying to assign this value to this variable, but Java compiler recognize that this value is a double by default. By default, any decimal value, Java compiler recognize that as a double value. Now I want to convert as a this float. That is very simple. At the suffix, you need to say f. That's it. If you say f, now this particular number considered as a float value. Now this float value we are able to assign inside a fvar variable. Okay, now I'm going to compile this. Now it's compiled now, because I mentioned here f at suffix of the value. That meaning compiler understand that this particular value is a float value. So this float value easily assigned to float type variable. Previously I have not mentioned the f, so that compiler by default assuming that this value is a double value, so the double value is not able to assign inside a float type fvar. That's the reason we were getting a compilation error. We need to say Java, right? Java. So I'm able to get the all the value, float variable value, double variable value, everything I'm able to get here. See here, long value, local B value, A value. I'm able to print a long value, float value, double value. Okay. Now in the integer variable, I'm trying to add some fractional numbers. I'm saying 30, right? Let's try to compile this. Oh, sorry guys. I want to compile. See, again it's saying is, since I added a 0.30, here added 0.30, again the compiler giving the same error because it's not able to convert double to int because in the program I am adding a decimal portion. By default, compiler recognize that this number considered as a double value, but I am trying to assign this value into integer type. That's the reason it's giving the error. So we need to remove it. Now we have not seen short, right? I'll going to declare short also. I want to give example for that also. Short s equal to 2. Let's see what's happening now. Compiled now. I want to print that value. I forgot to print. Short variable. Compiling and printing. Short variable. Typo error here. Don't mistake me. I will do like that sometime. Short. So now you understand that how to define a variables, different type of variables. Using data type concept, we can define different type of variable. If you want to define any particular data type, Java provides different keywords. Using that keywords, if we can define a different type of data type. Okay, here we are using short keyword, int keyword, long keyword, float keyword, double keyword. This variable called as a primitive data types. This variable called as a primitive data types. Okay. When you look at here, we are not defined string variable, right? Here I missed one more variable called char c equal to x. If you define any variable as a character type, we can store one character inside that variable. I will explain later part of the session what is the exact use of this character variable. Okay, and now you understand that inside a character variable we can store one character. That meaning one character, that character value must be enclosed within double quotes. See, I am saying char c equal to x. That x must be within a single quotes. Now I want to print that value here. char variable c. Okay, now I'm going to compile this. Okay, char variable x is printing here. So this variable called as a primitive data type. Now we need to say non-primitive data type. I will explain later, but you need to understand about string now. Okay, this is a primitive data type. This is non-primitive. String is a non-primitive. Okay. I can say string str1 equal to Suresh. String str2 equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. String is nothing but collection of character. For string type, we don't have a separate keyword for in primitive data type. We need to use this particular string. The string is nothing but class. It's a class type. str1 is a class type variable. is a class type variable. That's the reason we are saying it's a non-primitive data type. I will explain about this later. Okay, if you want to define any string variable, we need to use string str, string type. We need to use string type. Using string type, we can define a string type variable. Okay, this is come under non-primitive data type. Okay, when I start learning about object oriented programming, that time you definitely will understand what is non-primitive data type. Okay, as of now, please understand that if you want to define any string variable, we need to use string type. We need to use string type. Okay. If you want to print that value, just put SOP string type str1. Then str2. When you look at here, string str1, I am adding a Suresh. It's a collection of character. Str2 also collection of character, but it's a number, right? If any number you enclosed with double quotes, those things will not consider as a number value. This is not a number because I am enclosing within double quotes. This is not a number because I am enclosing within double quotes. So this considered as a string value. This considered as a string value. Okay. Even if you pass number value within double quotes, those values considered as a string value, not considered as a double. If you remove it, it will give error. If you remove it, it will give error. It will never work. If you compile, it will never work. Okay. See, it's giving error. Type int cannot be converted to string. It's clearly saying type int cannot be converted to string because it is a string type. Where I'm defining str2 as a string type variable, that string type variable must enclosed with double quotes. So now I'm going to compile. It will work perfectly. See here, str1 Suresh, str2 123456. So we have covered all necessary data types. Okay. Later part we're going to see about what is non-primitive data type. Okay. Now we're going to talk about arithmetic operator. We're going to talk about arithmetic operator. I don't want to give all the examples for arithmetic operator. All are self-explanatory. If you provide one example, okay. Arithmetic. Just will put arithmetic. This also inter. So here I am using two variables. I created two variables, int a and int b. I'll create this here. I assign value 10. Here I'm assigning value 3. Okay. When you look at arithmetic operator, here we can see plus and minus, star and forward slash and percentage symbol. Plus for adding two numbers. This example you have seen the first session itself. Adding two numbers, right? Here we will going to say like this. Plus A plus B, it will going to add the two values. That is the purpose of plus operator. Minus operator for subtract. Star for multiple. Forward slash for divide. So this and all self explanatory, right? You can easily work out by yourself. If you have any problem, let me know. Definitely, I will help you out. Okay. Then we'll go to see modulus operator. This percentage operator, the percentage symbol nothing but modulus operator. We'll call it as a modulus operator. We'll go to see the example of this modulus operator now. Okay. Now here I'll go and define one more variable C equal to A divided by B. A divided by B, then int D A percentage. A percentage B. Okay. Now I want to define this C and D value. C and D value. Output here is when I divide A divided by B, what will happen? The output is here 3, right? Here the result is 3 will come. If I divide 10 divided by 3, the result is 3 will come, right? Now this modulus operator return remainder value of divided value, remainder value of divided value. Okay, this modulus operator return remainder value from the divided value. Okay, we are dividing 10, right? From this value there is a remainder value, so 1. That value will assign to D variable. That value assigned to D variable. Let's see the output now. Okay. Java C, what is the class name? Or so we are getting 10 and 3. Why we are getting 10 and 3? I am printing A as it is, that is wrong. We need to print C here, right? C and D. Okay, so C will have a 3 value, D will have a 1, that is the expectation. Okay. So variables are case sensitive. We should not say capital C. Whatever case you are using, the same case we need to use here also. That is the error you are giving here. Okay. Now I am executing. C is a 3, D is a 1. 1 is a remainder value. After dividing the 10, we are getting one remainder value, right? That remainder value assigned to variable D. That is the output printing here. Okay, I hope you understand what is the purpose of modulus operator. It gives remainder value of remainder value from the divided value. Okay, I hope you understand about the modulus operator. Now we'll go into see that increment and decrement operator. Increment and decrement operator. Okay, I'll going to create one more class now. I already have increment. No. I'll open that increment. Okay, there is an increment, right? I'll going to define int C equal to A. So in the increment operator, here you can see there is a increment and decrement operator. We'll go to talk about now increment operator. In the increment operator itself, we have two category. One is post increment and pre-increment. This is a post increment operator. What is the meaning of post increment operator? Post increment operator nothing but here I am saying int C equal to A plus plus. What I am doing here actually I am assigning a value to C variable. I'm assigning A value to C variable. What is the value of A? Value of A is a 10, right? Post increment meaning, first whatever value available in the variable, that value assigned to C variable, assigned to the opposite variable. That meaning the A will give the 10 value to C. A will give the 10 value to C, then it will increase 1. Then it will increase 1. That meaning, after assigning A value to C, then A will become 11. A will become 11. So when I print here, A will return 11, C will return 10. Let's see the output now. I need to give semicolon here. See, A printing 11, C printing 10. Actually, in the A I am assigning 10 only here. Here A I am assigning 10 only here. But how it's printing 11 here? Reason is because of this post increment operator. What's happening here? When I say int C equal to A++, whatever variable value of A, that value first assign to C. What is the variable value of A? 10. 10 will assign to C. After assigning 10 to C, then A value increase 1. That meaning A value increase to 11. Okay, now A value will become 11. When I print A value here, it will print 11. When I print C value here, it will print 10. Because before increasing one value, it assigning A actual value C. A actual value is 10, right? That actual value printing here as a 10. I hope you understand what is a post increment. Okay. Now we are going to see the pre increment. I am going to comment out this entire statement. Pre-increment. Now the example of pre-increment here, the same similarly, yeah, I'm assigning A variable value to 10, then defining a new variable called C equal to plus plus A. What is the meaning of plus plus A? What will happen here? The A variable already 10, right? First it will going to increase the A variable value. Increase the A variable value by 1. That meaning it will going to become 11. That 11 value assigned to variable C. Okay, so variable C will have 11. Then A value will have 11. But here expected output is both will print 11, 11. Both will print 11, 11. Okay, let me check the output now. The previously A is 11, C is a 10. But now our expected output is A and C both should be 11, 11. Correct? Both should be 11, 11. I hope you understand what is the use of pre-increment and post-increment value. Now there is a decrement operator. Decrement operator, same concept I have explained. Here it's increasing one. Increasing one based on the scenario, whether it's post increment or pre increment, both the case increasing one. Okay. But in the case of minus minus, it's a decrement. Okay, it's a decrement. Please play with the decrement operator here. Okay, decrement operator is like kind of your assignment. Try with decrement operator. If you have any question, please ask me in the next session. Okay. Then what else we need to cover now? In the data type, we need to cover byte and boolean, right? I forgot to do that. Boolean variable, we can store either true or false. Okay, two value, two possible value we can store. I will give you the best example in the next upcoming classes. Okay. Byte variable, we can store byte data. Whatever data we are storing inside a computer, those are storing as a byte form, right? If you want to maintain byte data in a variable, in that case, we need to use byte type variable. If you want to define a byte variable, we have to say simply byte b equal to some number we can give. Again, the byte variable is a number value only. Okay, I will give the real uses later in the session. Okay, generally the byte variable we will going to maintain some image data and document data. I want to manipulate image, I want to manipulate document data. In such a case, we'll go with byte data type. Okay, definitely I will give you the one example for that from upcoming session. Okay, not now. So boolean, in the boolean we can create, we can define two different variable, right? Two different value. We can store two different value. Boolean b equal to either true or false. By default value is a false. We can say true like this. For this also I'll give the right example in the upcoming session. Okay. Even you can print this also, boolean b equal to true, we can print that also. It will just print true, that's it, nothing else. See, it's true. Okay, true is printing. Okay, we have covered the data type today. Tomorrow I'll going to continue rest of the Java operators. Now I want to explain some concept. I supposed to explain that in first session, but I don't want to confuse you. That's the reason I wanted to explain that. Okay, whenever you execute Java program, whenever you try to execute Java command, right, Java command, what's happening there behind the scene, that part we'll go to see now. Okay. Okay. So whenever we are saying Java, right? When I say Java, then class file name. We are saying some class file name, increment. Let's say in our case, increment. What is happening behind the scene? When I say Java increment, Java is a command to see the output, that you know perfectly. Java is a command to see the output of the program. Okay. What's happening behind the scene? Whenever you run this, execute the Java command, whenever you execute Java command, what will happen? Java command creates the JRE, Java Runtime Environment. Java Runtime Environment. Java Runtime Environment will going to create. Inside the Java Runtime Environment, we have one engine called JVM. That is called as Java Virtual Machine. Java Virtual Machine. Okay. Where this Java, shall we see this JRE? We cannot see this JRE. JRE is a set of memory in the computer RAM, it will run. Whenever you say Java increment, what will happen? This particular increment Java program needs some memory, right? That memory allocated by your JRE. That memory allocated by your JRE. JRE will run in your computer RAM. Computer RAM. So in that RAM, your JRE available. In that computer RAM, your JRE is available. Inside the JRE, we have a JVM, Java Virtual Machine. Java Virtual Machine. What will happen? This Java Virtual Machine take this particular file, whatever file we are using here. Here I am using increment. Take this increment file. That increment file interpret by JVM. Interpret by JVM. JVM will going to read that particular dot class file. Read that particular dot class file. Yesterday I told, right, that dot class file is a bytecode. We cannot understand whatever available in the bytecode, right? For example, let's say in the increment dot class, when you open this class, it has some junk character. This junk character we cannot understand by human as well as computer processor. Computer processor also cannot understand by this particular bytecode. Okay, this bytecode is an intermediate language. We can say it's an intermediate language. This intermediate language only understand by this particular JVM. Only understand by this particular JVM. Okay, what will happen? JVM take this dot class file. It will read that. Inside the JVM, we have a tool called interpreter. That interpreter will read that dot class file and convert that dot class file into particular operating system understandable format. Cut particular operating system understandable manner. For example, this my computer using particular processor, right? That processor to it a convert to understand to particular processor. Okay, according to that process, it is going to convert. Okay, that is the responsibility of this interpreter. Whenever you try to see the output of particular program, it is going to use a Java command. The Java command calls this JRE. Inside the JRE, we have a JVM. JVM is having many tools. There is one of the tool called interpreter. Interpreter will read that dot class file and convert that dot class file instruction to the particular computer processor understandable manner. That is a process happening in the behind the scene. Okay. Let's see here. So we are writing a program in Java file, then we are compiling using Java C compiler, then it will generate the dot class file. The dot class file nothing but bytecode. That bytecode converted into the bytecode interpret by our interpreter that is available inside a JVM. That interpret to machine code. Through that machine, the machine code read by our processor. Processor read that machine code and giving the output. This is the flow is happening in the behind the scene. Okay, so why this particular thing? In the case of C and C++, we don't have this concept, bytecode concept. We don't have the bytecode concept. Directly, it will convert. Whenever you write a program, when you run this program, what will happen? Directly, it will convert into a particular machine code. Directly, it never convert as a bytecode if you use any other language. But Java is different. Java will convert as a bytecode. That bytecode available inside a dot class file, right? Inside dot class file. So why this we need? The reason is because of this bytecode, Java become platform independent. Platform independent. You must have heard about that. Java is a platform independent. Once you write a program, once you compile a program, that particular dot class file you can run anywhere. You can run anywhere. So let's say I am creating one Java file inside a Windows operating system. I written a program. I'm compiling that program. Java compiler gives that dot class file for that program. Now that dot class file I can run in any other operating system, Mac operating system, Linux operating system, any other operating system I can run. Why? Because it's a dot class file. Whenever you run this dot class file in any other operating system, what will happen? In that operating system, Java runtime environment convert that particular class file bytecode into that operating system understandable manner. Okay, so dot class file is an intermediate file. That intermediate file we can execute any other operating system. Whenever you run dot class file any operating system, what will happen? Your JVM convert that dot class file into that particular operating system processor understanding manner. That is the concept of bytecode. Okay. Any doubt? Stop the session today.
Still not subscribe this channel? Please subscribe it. Share this video to your friend circle. Click bell icon for regular updates. Thanks for watching this full video.